every feeling that a woman can know.
I don't suppose his purse has got out to do with you, is he?
Shh, John.
Comes a governess and falls in love with her employer, Mr. Rochester.
In writing Jane Eyre, Charlotte released all the pent-up passion that had tortured her soul for 4 years. Like Monsieur Heger, Mr. Rochester was married. But unlike Charlotte, Jane Eyre's love was requited.
I love you as my own flesh. I entreat you. Jane, I must have you for my own. Entirely my own.
Jane flees the agonizing temptation of her love for a married man. Returning later, she finds he has been blinded in a fire that has killed his secret wife, leaving them free to marry at last.
Jane?
I've come back to you.
Such dreams I've had at night when I've clasped her to my heart as I do now and kissed her.
Through divine mercy and skill of a surgeon, after a year of nearly total blindness, I was able to read and write and find my way without a guide. The restoration of my sight was a miracle. And I prayed for another to save my son from his torment.
While Branwell pined for Mrs. Robinson, Charlotte was appalled to hear gossip that Arthur Bell Nichols was pining for her.
Never was rumour more unfounded. A cold, faraway sort of civility are the only terms on which I have ever been with Mr. Nichols.
Mr. Bell Nichols?
He and his fellow curates regard me as an old maid, and I regard them, one and all, as narrow and unattractive specimens of the coarser sex.
Mr. Bell Nichols.
She was more worried about her fictional romance.
Smith Elder had rejected the professor, but they discussed its faults and merits so kindly and with such courteousness that I take more pleasure in their refusal than in a thoughtless acceptance. They say a new work in 3 volumes will meet with their careful attention. I'm sending them Jane Eyre.
Well, I hope you have more success than we have had with Newby. We've heard nothing from him, have we, since we sent him all that money?
After breakfast, on a Sunday morning, I took the manuscript of Jane Eyre and began to read it. The story quickly took me captive. Presently, the servant came to say luncheon was ready. I asked him for a sandwich and a glass of wine and still went on with Jane Eyre. A hasty dinner followed. And before the night was out, I had finished that extraordinary novel.
On the 19th of October, 1847, Jane Eyre was published to instant acclaim.
Jane Eyre is a book to make the pulses gallop and the heart beat and to fill the eyes with tears. The figures are bold, true, well-defined, full of life. Mr. Currabell possesses narrative power in an uncommon degree.
Jane Eyre combines masculine hardness, coarseness and freedom of expression with a heathenist doctrine of religion.
Despite, or perhaps because of, the mixed reviews, Jane Eyre was a runaway success and was rapidly reprinted. The eminent author William Makepeace Thackeray was full of praise.
I am honored to be approved by Mr. Thackeray. But I think it's time I told Papa about Jane Eyre.
Charlotte, I've been reading your book. I think it's a better book than I expected. Don't stay up too late now, girls.
Thank you, Papa.
In a bid to exploit the success of one of the Bell brothers, Emily and Anne's publisher, Thomas Courtly Newby, had finally brought out Wuthering Heights and Agnes Grey.
Agnes Grey is a sort of younger sister to Jane Eyre. It teaches us to put every trust in supreme wisdom and goodness.
Wuthering Heights is wild, confused, disjointed, and improbable. Vulgar depravity and unnatural horrors. The people are savages.
The violence and amorality in Wuthering Heights caused a sensation. Charlotte was deeply hurt by the critics' attacks on her sister, but Emily paid no heed. To her publisher's delight, she started work on a second novel. Anne also began another novel, The Tenant of Wildfell Hall, a story fired by her horror at Branwell's adulterous affair and decline into alcoholism. It was a dark tale, which depicted the destructive effects of drink and loose morals on the young, and the efforts of a good woman to protect her son.
So my little Arthur came down every evening and learned to tipple wine like Papa.
She smelt it!
To swear and to have his own way like a man, and sent Mama to the devil when she tried to prevent him.
Grandmother begged me to bring him 5 pennyworth of gin to get him through tonight. Pitiful they were. Parson did what he could. Never stopped hoping the boy would find himself again. But his sisters had given up on him.
Meanwhile, Thomas Courtly Newby had tried to sell The Tenant of Wildfell Hall to an American publisher, claiming that it was by the author of Jane Eyre.
We must all go to London immediately to prove to my publisher that we have no part in Newby's fraud. Hurry. We don't have much time if we have to catch the train from Keighley. Emily?
Mr. Smith will have to make do with Currer and Acton Bell. Ellis has no desire to go to London.
On the 8th of July, 1848, Charlotte and Anne arrived at the London offices of George Smith.
We were dressed in the plain country garments which were the only ones we possessed. I smiled at the contrast between me and Mr. Smith.
How can I help?
My name is Charlotte Bronte. You may know me as Cora Bell. And this is my sister Anne, Acton Bell. If you would like proof of our identities, you may recognize this letter that you sent to me only last week.
How extraordinary.
Explanations, talk, talk, talk. Tonight you must go to the Italian Opera. You must see the exhibition. Mr. Thackeray would be pleased to see you. Talk, 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 until I offered a grave explanation that no one was to know the true identity of the Bell brothers. Mr. Smith did not like the quiet plan, but consented. He made himself altogether very pleasant.
I must confess, my first impression of Charlotte Bronte's personal appearance was... it was interesting rather than attractive. She was very small and had a quaint, old-fashioned look. Her head seemed too big for her body. But she had fine eyes. She seemed to have an excessive anxiety about her appearance. I believe she would have given all of her genius to have been beautiful.
Charlotte's correspondence with George Smith took a new turn, and through their letters, the couple began to fall in love.